Ramanujan for G is now available on the Google Play Store. Try it out for free.
Student, our last class in the differences between amorphous and crystalline solids, and also different kinds of crystalline solids. That there we studied about the covalent. There we studied about different kind of crystalline solids in our last class. So those solids actually depend on the interparticle interactions. If the interparticle interactions is a covalent interaction, like that happens in the case of diamond or silica, so then that kind of crystal structure or crystalline solid is referred to as a covalent crystal, so covalent solids. Then if the interparticle interactions is the electrovalent or ionic bond, then we call such solids or such crystals as ionic crystals or ionic solids. And if the interparticle interactions are weak non-covalent interactions, then such crystals we say as a molecular solids. If the interparticle interaction is metal, that happens in the case of pure metals, then we call such solids as a metallic solid. But depending on this interaction strength of these interactions, the melting and boiling point of these materials also changes. So usually covalent bonds are very strong, so the covalent solids have highest melting and boiling point. Covalent solids, I am saying, it means if the interaction between all the particles is a covalent bond, it doesn't mean the molecules having covalent bonds are having high melting and boiling point. For example, water. The water molecules are arranged each other with the help of weak non-covalent interactions. The example is the hydrogen bond that we call. That is why in the solid state, this interaction, since weak interactions, these are weak interactions, so the solids are usually liquid or volatile liquids, or sometimes even the gases at the room temperature. So these things we have seen very much examples. These examples and interactions, you can help you to understand if some question comes that what kind of solid this is. So there you can see what kind of interactions can be found between different particles or different constituting particles of the solid. Based on that, you can easily find out that what kind of solid it could be. So you don't have to remember most of the things. Like if you see, think that this molecule can exist independently and this molecule has a covalent bonds, then you can easily think it's a covalent bonded molecule, a single molecule, and it can exist independently. So what you can say, if the interaction between two molecules will always be because of the weak interactions, or even the atoms like argon and so. And similarly, if there are ions, in the ions there is no directionality and no ion is saturated, the interaction happens from all directions. One ion can simultaneously interact with many ions from different directions. So definitely then if the ions are there, the solid is ionic. Similarly, if there are metals, as I said earlier, if there are metals involved, metallic atoms, so there will always be metallic, those such crystals will always be metallic crystals of, you can say, metallic solids. So these are examples, few basic things that help you to understand the conceptual basis of these different solids. So now let us see the crystal lattice. So this is one thing that we usually talk in the crystal when we deal or we talk about the crystal structure. There you need to understand two things. So one thing is called motif or basis, and another is called the lattice point. Once you understand the lattice points and motifs and you combine them together, that means you just arrange these motifs or basis on the lattice point in a particular fixed orientation, you get the crystal structure. What does it mean? It means it helps you to suggest that now these motifs are nothing but the constituent particle of a solid. These constituent particles could be an ion or ion or the pair, ion pair like NaCl, or could be a atoms, or they could be like atoms means in the case of suppose iron crystals, it would be metals, and then or even argon, if solid argon, solid krypton, this kind of the, and if such constituent particles are molecules, they can be molecules like we see the solid CCl4 or solid CO2. So what we say that the points at which these motifs could be arranged or kept in a crystal structure, that those points are called lattice points. For example, you just look at your surface and somewhere the where the these tiles are arranged. So the central point of each tile you can call as a lattice point, and this tile then will called as a motif, because this motif, this is the basis, this is arranged on those lattice points, this is kept on those lattice point to make this surface. So similarly in the solids, what we see, the motifs are usually the structural units or the base, this is also so called the basis, like in the case of NaCl, Na and 1Na plus and Cl minus means NaCl is one motif. In case of CCl4 molecule, if it is in solid state, CCl4 is a motif. Similarly, if it is a copper crystal, that the copper atom will be a motif. If it's the it is the ice, the motif is H2O. And this, the central point of these motifs in the crystal structure, wherever you say that if it's a molecule, the center mass you can consider is an atom. It's very easy to understand, and usually in your syllabus it is atom or ions that is given. You don't have to study about the molecular solids. So what in this figure, what we say, this all the central points, there are gaps if you look at this between this point, and this is the distance that we'll see what this distance mean later on. And this is a motif that we, as I say, this NaCl is on one ionic kind of motif I have shown here. And if these motifs are arranged in this particular arrangement, the fixed arrangement, then only we get a crystal structure. If they are randomly arranged, this is not a crystal. It could be an amorphous solid. Amorphous solids, as we have seen in our last class, they are kind of, their structure is more closer to the liquid structure. So they are very viscous liquids, they are not solids, as we see in the case of glass. And this very viscous solids, it means they are not stable, they are not in equilibrium, they are some in the metastable state, and in some local minima, they are not in the global minima, that is that refers to the crystal structures. So slowly there is also movement in those solids, means in the glass, and it also slowly converts into the global minimum, that means the crystal structure. That is why in the 1000 years old glass age of Church Age, many places that it has been found that this glass is getting converted into the small crystals. This is one example, and also it has been observed that if you keep a glass in the one vertical position for a very long time, you see the thickness of glass, it changes. So it becomes more thicker at the bottom because of the gravity, there is flow there. So this flow is continuous and it is very slow. That is why glasses are very viscous liquids, and so also called the supercooled liquids. So okay, let's see those examples. Few examples we have seen earlier. Now we see some more concept here. So motifs, also known as basis, is a structural unit. As I said, the central point of each motif is called a lattice point. Lattice point, as we see here. So a space lattice, we know the lattice point is also called a crystal lattice, is the pattern of points representing the locations of these motifs. So this pattern, in this is a 2D pattern, hypothetical pattern. Usually in solids we don't get 2D patterns, so their arrangement is in the three-dimensional space. So this is just example, the hypothetical example to show you the concept. So in a space, like this is called the arrangement of these points, lattice points, is called a space lattice or crystal lattice. And this pattern, basically, in other words, what we say, the space lattice is an abstract scaffold for crystal structure. Scaffold, you know, that where these motifs are arranged. So there is that is called a scaffold. So when we place motifs in an identical manner on points of a space, lattice points of a space lattice, we get crystal structures. So when we arrange these motifs on the points of this lattice points of this space lattice, we get crystal structure. Mm-hmm. So three points, the definition you should understand: a space lattice or crystal lattice is simply pattern of lattice points, it is not a crystal structure. There is motif, those the constituent particles of a solid, they are motifs. Once you arrange these constituent particles on the space lattice or crystal lattice, you get the crystal structure, and that is the real solid structure. That is, the arranging motifs on the lattice points generate crystals, That's one thing. The spatial arrangement of lattice points gives rise to different types of lattices. Means these lattice points could be arranged in different types, and based on that, we get different type of lattices. What are those different types? We'll see a little later. In the case of crystalline solids, a space lattice is the three-dimensional array of points. We see, so the example that was shown is a 2D, two-dimensional example, but what we see in reality, that the solid is a three-dimensional structure. So in the case of crystalline solids, the space lattice is a three-dimensional array of points or three-dimensional pattern. It is not a two-dimensional pattern. So the crystal structure is obtained by associating a structural motif with lattice points. So in the 3D lattice points, if you put the constituent particles of that particular solid, what we get is a crystal structure of that particular solid. Each repeated basis or motif has same structure and same spatial orientation as other one in a crystal. So this I explained. So each repeated basis or motif has the same orientation and same structure in the crystal structure. You don't have, it is not arranged in different direction or something. If that is there, it is an amorphous solid, it's not a crystal solid. So that is why, because of those arrangements, what happened, these interactions are maximized, or so that the structure interaction are minimized, means the interaction means the energy is minimized, interactions are maximized, means the attractive interactions are maximized. The environment of each motif is same throughout the crystal except for the on the surfaces, means that if you look at in the bulk or anywhere in the middle of a solid, what you see, environment of one motif or one structural unit is constant everywhere in the crystal, other than on surfaces. Surfaces, what you, when we cut a solid, we get a surface, and that is why this some unsaturation are found on the surfaces. That is why these surfaces are used as a catalyst in catalysis. We know this is a branch of chemistry where different kind of reactions are performed, and people use different chemicals to enhance the reactivity or rate of the reactions. So that is what they are called catalysts. So at surfaces are used as a catalyst because there are some unsaturation. This unsaturation comes because the spatial, this arrangement of all the particles around one particle or one constituent particle is not same as it is found in the bulk of the solid or in the middle of the solid anywhere. So characteristics of a crystal lattice are there. So but we see that there are these points we need to understand. So there are certain characteristics of a crystal lattice, and these characteristics, basically what we see is that each point in a lattice is called lattice point or lattice site. We saw this. So each point, again I am saying, each point in a lattice is called lattice point or lattice site. Or each point in a crystal lattice represent one constituent particle, which may be an atom, a molecule, or an ion. This is one thing, that these points we have already seen, just a kind of revision or repetition to make you understand even better. And the third characteristic is the lattice points are joined by straight lines to bring out the geometry of the lattice. They are joined, these lattice points are joined by, just to show it, joined by us, straight lines to bring out the geometry of the lattice. So if you join them by solid lines, what you get is, you get the geometry of that particular lattice, and how we'll see later on when we see different kind of unit cells and how these unit cells are arranged to get a crystal structure. How we can find from the unit cells a crystal structure, or from a crystal structure, how will we find a unit cell, that we'll see a little later. So a crystal lattice can be defined as a geometrical arrangement of constituent particles of matter. These are total four. There are total 14 three-dimensional lattices. This is one thing that we'll again see in more details. So just to remember it, just that there are 14 possible three-dimensional lattices. These are called Bravais lattices, which was actually explained by the French scientist Bravais. And each point in a lattice represent a lattice site or lattice point. each point denotes a particular type of constituent particles of matter, be it atom, molecule, or an ion. And this, you can see the crystal lattice, sorry, units. There are many units that are arranged together here. One can consider, or but we see this, you can see one small crystal of a particular solid. And in a small crystal, what you can see, if you look at this point, this, you can consider it as a unit cell. So these are just one unit cell. So there are total 8 unit cells that are joined together. So you can call them as a small crystal. And what kind of this unit cell would be, we will see now. So let's see first what is a unit cell. As I said, so we need only a small part of a space lattice of a crystal to specify crystal completely. What we have seen in our last class, that one, you can focus just on one part of a very small portion of a crystal, and whatever the property and arrangement of atoms you find there, it will be in anywhere in the solid. Wherever you go, you will find the same arrangement of atoms there as well. So to understand the entire atomic or the constituent part arrangement of constituent particles, you don't have to look at the entire crystal. So what we look at, a very small portion, and that smallest portion that can actually explain the entire arrangement of a particular crystal, the smallest unit is the unit cell. And that we see, that's just a repetition of that unit cell. The periodicity is there because of that. Just arrange one above one, and one beside one, you will get an entire crystal structure. So this small part is called a unit cell. One can choose unit cell in many ways. So to choose unit cell in what we need, so there is a crystal structure. From there, I am trying to find out what could be this part and the last point. Crystal. So to do that, what we usually do is we try to find the different perpendicular sides, and those sides we took the shortest length. How we choose, we look at the different distance between different atoms, two adjacent atoms, and based on that we find out the dimensions of the unit cell. Also, a unit cell have shapes such as such that this when I form a unit cell, if I just arrange different unit cell, I should get the crystal structure. And that if I arrange those unit cells, there should not be any gap between two unit cells. If there is a gap, then you will not get the crystal structure exactly. So there should not be any gap between two unit cells while defining unit cell of any solid. So this example that we see, this is unit cell you can consider in a 2D dimension, and just you repeat it or translate it in this different direction, or just keep adding on one by one, you'll get the 2D crystal. So usually there are no, and this in two dimension, you can say the see the dimensions of different kind of unit cells. We can see that there are all the sides are same, but the angles are not same. The sides are not same, but angles are same, like this, what we see in case of rectangle. So all the sides are same, angle is also same, but And similarly, you can see all the these angles are same, like here, the opposite angles are same, the sides are same, and here the sides may not be the same, but we see. And if such things we find in the three-dimensional space, what we find is the real unit cell of a solid. And this is one example. We see the unit cell that I have explained. So in the 3D space, what we find is a unit cell could be kind of this kind of things. So there are three sides of a unit cells usually what we find, and there are three angles that can define the unit cell as well. So to define a unit cell in three-dimensional space, we need six parameters, and these six parameters are three sides, three distances, and three angles. And three distances means that in different along different axes, if you go, what are the distances between two adjacent atoms? If you go along choose one atom as a origin, and you go along x direction, and whatever the distance you get between two adjacent, I mean the next atom and at the origin, that is one unit, or you can call it as a. And if you go along y-axis and you get to the next atom at the distance b, that is one parameter. And you go along a z-axis and you find next atom along a z-axis at the distance c. So there are three parameters that is called called the edges. We say sometimes here you can consider it as them as a edges if this is a cuboidal. So this A, B, and C, they are edges, and since these are cuboid, there will be three angles as well. So these angles, I say, if in this cuboid, alpha, beta, and gamma, these angles here will be 90 degree, but it is not necessary that these angles and these sides will always be same. We see different kind of crystals where these sides differ or the angles differs. How that we will see in details little later. So in a 3D crystal structure, unit cells is characterized by its dimension along three edges, and dimension along three edges that we call A, B, C, and these parameters. These edges may or may not be mutually perpendicular. So if these edges, it means that these alpha, beta, and gamma angles that is formed between two edges, they may not be the same. What we see usually is if the angle between A and B means x and y axis, usually it is called gamma. And here it is written, so between B and C, A and B, it is gamma. Between B and C, you see this angle is alpha, and between C and A, these two edges, this angle is called beta. So you remember this as this, between B and C, alpha is between B and C in the cyclic manner, beta is between C and A, and gamma is between A and B. So these angles between the edges, so there are six parameters which actually defines a unit cell completely. So based on this, unit cells are broadly divided into two types. And two types, there are primitive unit cell and centered unit cell. Primitive unit cells, in which the constituent particles are located on the corners of the lattice. So whatever the what is the primitive unit cell, so all the constituent particles will be arranged only at the corners. There will be no atoms in the middle or on the face or anywhere. So all the atoms are at only corners, means there are is eight corners, so they will be at eight corners only. So such unit cells are called primitive unit cells. And then centered unit cells, one is the centered unit cells. What we see, the atoms are arranged on the corners, that is fixed here as well. What we see in addition to that, atoms are also arranged somewhere, sometimes on the faces, sometimes on the sometimes on in the center of this cubic cell or this unit cell, and sometimes we see the atoms are arranged on the opposite sides, opposite faces, not sides, opposite faces. So based on this, what is it? The centered unit cells, the unit cell in which the constituent particles are located on the corners, that we say corners in this as well, the atoms will be arranged, as well as other positions of the lattice, you know, as centered unit cells. So the other positions also the atoms will be arranged. So a centered unit cell is further divided into three types based on where that additional atom is kept all the additional atoms have been kept. Based on that, we divide centered unit cells into three different types. One is called body centered unit cell. Body centered unit cells means the another one, there are eight atoms on the corner of the unit cell and there is one atom at exactly at the center of the unit cell. That is called a body centered unit cell. Body centered, by its name you can easily guess, body centered means this one atom is on the center of the body. Then face centered unit cells, so this, suppose this is a cube, so but this is one face, this is another face, this is another face, this will be another, they're coming out and one going back there. So there are six faces of a cube. So if there are six atoms at six faces, then we say the face centered unit cell. And with six atoms around six faces, but there will also atoms on the corners as well in this. Then the third one is called end centered unit cell. In end centered unit cell, what we see, the eight atoms are on the eight corners, and also what we see, two atoms are two on two opposite faces. So suppose if this face there is one atom, so another atom will be on this. Or if the eight atoms are on the corner and one atom is here, then the next atom will be here. That is called end centered. So these are the examples that as divisions are based on the experimental studies. This is what we find in the solids, and based on that, this information are this kind of classifications are made. So the body centered unit cell that I have explained, I think face centered also, and this we have seen there. So inspection of a wide variety of crystal leads to the conclusion that all can be regarded as conforming to one of the seven regular figures. So this means that if you look at the all kind of solids, crystalline solids that we see in the nature, or even while we crystallize a particular, after synthesizing a particular kind of substance, and if we crystallize it, so all these kind of things have been studied mostly, and based on that, it has been found. It has been found that all the solids, you can divide them into seven regular figures. Seven regular figures means one is the cube I said. So similarly, we'll see the orthorhombic, monoclinic, and those seven figures. And these seven figures are actually based on the alpha, beta, gamma angles, and A, B, and C edges. Their mutual relationship, that actually based on that, these seven kind of regular structure of a unit cell has been classified. So these basic regular figures are called seven crystal systems. The seven crystal systems were what? The seven regular figures that we see for a unit cell, to which system a given crystal belongs to is determined by measuring the angles between its faces, as I said, and deciding how many axes are needed to define the principal features of its cell. So how many axis means axis along axis. If we see the distance between two adjacent atoms, that we define as A, and similarly A, B, and C, those edges, the distance. So edges, distance of those edges, that is why these three or six things that decide the different kind of crystal system. So they are seven. And what are those seven that we see? One is the cubic. In the cubic crystal system, we can find the primitive. We know all the atoms are only at the corners. Or the body centered, here also we find the body centered means the atoms are on the corner as well as at the center of the cube. And the face centered, the atoms are on the corners as well as the center of each face or each six faces. In the cubic crystal systems, what we find that these edges A and B, A, B, and C, are they are of the same length. Cube, we know cube, all the sides are of the same length. And the angles also, we know the cubes, what will the angles, alpha, beta, and gamma, all those angles will be of 90 degree. So these are things, the examples of this cubic crystal systems are NaCl, zinc blend, and copper. The copper metal, we know that it forms a crystal structure. So these are examples of cubic lattices or cubic crystal systems. So they similarly similar to the cubic crystal systems, there is another, the tetragonal. So seven crystal systems are cubic, tetragonal, orthorhombic, hexagonal, rhombohedral or trigonal, or monoclinic, triclinic. These are seven crystal systems, and the based on these seven crystal systems, there are some more possibility for one crystal systems. And if you look at all this, we find 14 different kind of crystals, and as or crystal lattices, that is called Brevis lattices. So 3, 2, 5, and 4, 9, 10, and 4, this, so total 14 what we see here. Then the tetragonal is defined. How we look at the tetragonal unit cell, to understand that you make a some kind of figure where two sides are same and the third side C is not equal to the other two sides A and B, but two sides are only same, and the all the alpha, beta and gamma angles are of 90 degree. Then this is called tetragonal. So in cubic lattice, what you do, you just increase the distance C or decrease the distance C, then A and B, and rest of the things are still same. Then this kind of crystal system is called tetragonal crystal system. The example of tetragonal system crystal system is white tin, HNO2, TiO2, titanium oxide, calcium sulfate, stannous oxide is stannous oxide. So there are stannous and stannic, tin in plus two four oxidation, this is stannic, sorry, plus four oxidation state, this is stannic, and plus two oxidation state, this is stannous. So by these things we have studied in our periodic properties, that tin can be found in plus two and plus four oxidation state, plus four oxidation, plus two. Why it is we find it in the plus two oxidation state? Because of the inert pair effect. And those things we have studied. So the third type of crystal system is the orthorhombic. Orthorhombic is what we see in this case. We see all the angles are same. They are on 90 degree, but there is no but the sides are not of the same length. So all the sides are of different length, but all the angles are of 90 degree. They are of the same value. So these kind of examples are rhombic sulfur, potassium nitrate, barium sulfate, also from the calcium sulfate from tetragonal crystals, but barium sulfate, it forms orthorhombic crystal. So the tetragonal here, we see it forms two kind of different kind of crystals. So crystal lattice is from the primitive or body centered. Primitive, we know, only atoms will be only at the corners. The body centered, we know, one atom will be also at the center of the body. But in the case of orthorhombic, we find four different kinds of lattice, Brevis lattices, the lattice structure, and there's a primitive, body centered, face centered and end centered. All the things that we have seen earlier means the body centered, the primitive, and or another what we have seen, primitive and centered unit cell. Primitive unit cell and centered unit cell. Centered unit cell, three types: body centered, face centered and end centered. And all these four we find in the case of the orthorhombic crystal system. And orthorhombic crystal system, in that, how will you understand whether this crystal system is orthorhombic? So for that you need to measure all the sides. If they are of not same length and but all the angles are of same value, then you say that this is the orthorhombic unit cell. Then the hexagonal unit cell, if you look at the crystal system, hexagonal unit crystal system is, or the unit cell is of the hexagonal shape. Usually this means the cubic crystal system is the unit cell is of cubic shape, tetragonal shape. But this is how it is defined. So hexagonal means the unit cell is of hexagonal shape. In hexagonal shape means what? Two sides A and B are of the same length. Any two sides you can say, any side you can call A and any side B or C. It just depends on how you consider where the x-axis is. So the two sides are same and the third side is of different length. But what we see, the two angles alpha and beta, but here alpha and beta angle, then we will have to think of alpha is angle between B and C, and beta is C and A. So alpha is, and beta are of 90 degree and the gamma is 120 degree. Then such unit cell is called, then we see the unit cell takes a hexagonal shape, and the example is graphite, zinc oxide, cadmium sulfide. These are few examples. Then the rhombohedral or trigonal, that it is a bit difficult to remember these names, but you can do it easily. Or they might also find some tricks to remember. A rhombohedral, this there we find only primitive unit cell. In the hexagonal unit cells, we find only primitive atoms are only at the corners. Atoms are not found at the body, center of the body, or center of the face, or even the two opposite faces. The example of rhombohedral unit cell or the crystal system is the calcite. Calcite is nothing but calcium carbonate, and the HGS, which is also called the cinnabar. So these are ores, different kind of ores. That is why their name is calcite, cinnabar. The monoclinic crystal system, then we see out of seven monoclinic system, crystal system, we see the possible variations only primitive and end center. Primitive all at the corner, and end center means all the atoms are at all the corners as well as at two opposite faces. In this case, in the monoclinic case, what we see, the sides are not of the same length. Alpha and beta angle are of 90 degree, but alpha and gamma angles are 90 degree, but beta angle, it could be any. It can take any value. It is not defined. It will simply that it will not be of 90 degree. So if it is 90 degree, then it will be orthorhombic. Because the difference between orthorhombic and monoclinic, what we say, the sides are not same of the same length. Only thing is the alpha and gamma of same length in monoclinic, and beta is not of 90 degree. If beta also becomes of 90 degree, we get this orthorhombic shape. The rhombohedral that we have not seen it, A and B and C, all the sides are of same length, but alpha and beta and gamma, or none of those angles are of 90 degree. The triclinic then comes. Triclinic, we find only primitive kind of atomic arrangement in the unit cell, and this primitive triclinic is defined when all the angles are of different length, and all the angles are of different value, and they are not equal to 90 degree, means none of the angle is of 90 degree, and also these angles take different values, but the sides are also of different length, they are not of the same value. So if all the sides are not of the same length, all the angles are not of the same value, and they are also not equal to 90 degree, we see that we call that such a unit cell as a triclinic, or the such a crystal system, then we call that as a triclinic crystal system. The example that we see in such cases is the potassium dichromate, copper sulfate. The copper sulfate, we also see some water molecules, hydrated water molecules, five water molecules usually. So copper sulfate, if you the unhydrated copper sulfate is a hygroscopy, it can absorb water from the moisture, and so on. So if we look at this seven crystal systems, how their unit cells will look like, we can see these structures. The cubic crystal system, we see all the A, B and C, they are of same length. A is this, B is also equal to A, C is also equal to A, and one we see angle alpha is 90 degree. Alpha is what? Between B and C. Beta is between C and C and A, and gamma is between A and B. So this is A and this is B. So this is B, means this will also be B. If this is A, this will also be A, and this is also A. If this is C, this is also C, this is one is also C. So between the, but we see all the angles alpha, beta, gamma, they are 90 degrees. So such a crystal system is cubic crystal system, and unit cell is a cubic unit cell. A tetragonal, what we see usually A, B and C here, they are same, but what we see alpha and beta are also same. The only gamma is, C is larger than A and B, not of the same length. It could be even a smaller here. In this example, it is more than A and B. So A and B are of same value, C is more than A and B, but the angles are, all the angles are 90 degrees. Similarly, orthorhombic, you can see A, B, C, A is smaller, and the B, C is, we don't see they are of, see here, orthorhombic, they are of not same length, but the angle, all the angles we see there, 90 degrees. In a hexagonal, you see this is the hexagonal, A, B, C. Similarly, the two angles are 90 degree and one angle is 120 degree between the gamma. That gamma angle is 120 degree means between sides A and B. This is hexagonal unit cell. Similarly, the rhombohedral unit cell, you can see. So while defining unit cell, if you see, this is the best, means you find this kind of unit cell arrangement, you can call such a crystal system as a rhombohedral crystal system. If you find a crystal system, the arrangement of unit cell in this shape, monoclinic, then you can call such a crystal system as a monoclinic, and then that could be a triclinic. And how they are defined, we have seen earlier, based on the relations between different angles and different sides. Now, this French mathematician Breves showed that there are only 14 possible three-dimensional lattices. These are called Breves lattices. And Breves lattices, as I said, in the seven crystal systems, we find this, a particular kind of crystal systems. There could be different arrangement of atoms. Like in case of cubic crystal systems, we see the arrangement could be of three different types. In case of tetragonal, we see this, there could be two different types of arrangement. In orthorhombic, we see maximum the four different type of arrangements. Hexagonal and rhombohedral, we see only one. And triclinic as well, only one arrangement. And the monoclinic, we see also that there are two different kinds of arrangements. So overall, what we see usually is 14 different kind of possible arrangements of atoms. And this is called the Breves lattices, and there are only 14 types. And 14 types, we see what here, these are three different, these are cubic crystal system, three different arrangements of atoms. So what we see, the primitive, as I said, all the atoms will be only at the corners, all the corners, eight corners, and then it is a primitive. If the atoms are at all the corners and also at the center of the body, at the center of the cubic cell, then it's called body centered. And then if we find that all atoms are at each corner as well as at the center of each faces, this is one face, so we find one atom here, this is another one, another face, the one atom is here, another face. So similarly, six faces and atoms will be at the center of all the faces, So there will be six atoms at six faces as well. Now, what we see that tetragonal, that could be two. The primitive, all the atoms at only corners, and then would be body centered, means all the corners as well as one atom will be on the center of the body. And unit cells two, the one side different in length to other, two angles between four. Faces all are 90 degree. That is one thing that we have seen. Now, what we see, the orthorhombic. The orthorhombic, this shape is orthorhombic shape. Orthorhombic shape, but we know the angles of all the faces are 90 degree, and but the sides are not equal. None of the sides are equal. The A and B and C, they are of different length, but the all the angles are 90 degree. But in such a case, what we see, that the atoms could be arranged in four different fashions. So four different fashions are there. This crystal could be primitive, only at corner, means atoms are only at the corners. End centered means atoms at the corner and two opposite faces, this and this. And body centered, we see, means other than corners, one atom is also at the center, and the face centered, other than corners, but we see six atoms at the centers of the six faces. And this is, we see in case of orthorhombic crystal systems, these four different kind of atomic arrangements. So four different kind of crystal systems we observe in that case. Crystals we observe in that case of four different kind of unit cells as well. And then the case of monoclinic lattices, we see only two different kind of atomic arrangements and unit cells. One is primitive and one is end-centered. A monoclinic means the, all the sides are unequal and two faces have angle. So different to 90 degree. So this value given here. So all the atoms here, all the corners and then end-centered, the atoms at corner as well as atoms on the two opposite faces. And in this case, what we find the two angles, this one angle is more than 90 degree, one is less than 90 degree, means none of the angles are of the same value. Then in the case, what we see, this is a hexagonal and this is rhombohedral and this is triclinic. In all these cases, we see only one kind of atom. Kind of atomic cells, so their atoms are only found at the corners. Then we'll see one by one. Similarly, we have seen these values as all the cubic crystal systems, but we find a primitive body centered and face centered cubic lattices. This we should remember, primitive body centered and face centered. Some kind of questions will be asked, so we will see the packing of these atoms as well, different packing fraction that is called, and that those things we will see a bit later. Then the orthorhombic, we see the primitive body centered, face centered, base centered. Base centered means end centered. And what is orthorhombic? Alpha, beta, gamma, and ABC relationship we know. Then the tetragonal lattices, again primitive and body centered. I'm repeating, you see these shapes and how the atoms are arranged based on that. Two different crystal lattices, monoclinic, we see two types, the base of end centered and as well as primitive. Hexagonal, we see only one kind of arrangement, but we see at all the corners. This is one hexagon, and the hexagon, the overall, the so entire structure is a hexagonal structure. In the hexagonal structure, atoms are at all the corners only. There is no atom at the faces or at the center. We don't see in this case. In the trigonal and triclinic, shape looks like this. They are triclinic atomic arrangement. Atomic volume in a cubic unit cell. In a cubic unit cell that we see, there are three different kind of crystal lattices and three different with primitive and then body centered and the face centered. The primitive, what we see in the primitive, atoms are only at the corners, but while defining unit cell, one thing that we have studied is unit cells, when we arrange two unit cells, there should not be any gap between two unit cells to find a crystal structure. What does it mean? This atom, different one atom that is at the corner is not shared by only one atom. It is basically shared by also the neighboring unit cells. Means it is not shared by only one unit cell. It will also be shared by different unit cells. So in the case, if the atom is at the corner, what we see, this, if the atom is at the corner, it is actually shared by eight different unit cells. So what we see here, one unit cell, the one is back of it, this one, then another unit cell is here, and then another unit cell is here. So what we see at the bottom side, there are four unit cells. Similarly, four unit cells will be on this side. So there will be this one atom at one corner is shared by eight different unit cells. So only one by eighth of the atom will be in one unit cell. So overall atomic volume of one, this atom, a particular atom in one unit cell, will be only by 1/8 of that, the volume of the atom. So we see this kind of things. So if you just cut it down, but we see this kind of shapes, the atoms are also cut down, and this are smooth edges, this kind of things. And so, but if the suppose an atom is at the center of the body, center of the body, like here, center of the body, it is only, it is perfectly in a, one unit cell. It is not shared by any other unit cell because it is surrounded by the corner atoms as well, because it has to be adjusted so that the this atom should not go out of this, means it should not clash with the atoms that are at the corners. If you want, if you do that, you find that this entire atom is only in the one cubic cell only. So all the entire volume of this atom is only in the only one cubic cell. But if it is the face centered, in face centered, but we see these kind of things, if the one atom is shared by two different unit cells, so the half of the cell is only in one unit cell, and half that we see this looks like this when we take a section of a unit cell. So based on that, we'll see how the total, the packing of that unit cell, and based on the packing, we'll see the packing fraction as well. So in the body centered cubic structure, this is a body centered cubic structure. What we see in the primitive cubic structure, what we see, one, there are eight atoms at each corner, but only 1/8 of the volume of one atom is in the, that particular unit cell. So what we see, effectively, we see only one atom is in that unit cell in the primitive cubic lattice. But in the case of body centered cubic lattice, what we see is eight atoms at the corner, means at the corners, the contribution of atoms is only 1/8. So 1/8 into such, there are eight such structural units. So we have 8 × 1/8. So one atom completely means one in the unit cell, because of the contribution will also be of the one atom, because this entire atom is in the this unit cell only. So what we see, the total number of atoms present in one unit cell will be 2. So 1/8 × 1/8 corners of each corner, plus 1 × 1, that is whether it is one atom in the center of the body, so that is 1 × 1. So there are only 2 atoms that are effectively present in one unit cell in a body centered cubic lattice that looks like this. Usually there is no gap. Usually we don't find a gap between these two atoms. The atoms are actually, they look like this, but have a better picture to visualize is better. We make these atoms smaller. So you can just think of this. We show here only the nucleus of these atoms. So anyway, so anode nucleus, even the nucleus plus core electrons, so the kernel is shown, because the nucleus is very negligible volume, that may confuse you. So what I mean to say is that the total atoms, the contribution or the total number of atoms present in the body centered cubic lattice is only 2. And how you will get, you have to just understand these figures, the contributions, how these unit cells are arranged. So what fraction or what portion of that particular cell is in a particular particular atom is in a particular unit cell. So if it is at the corner, the contribution is only 1/8. If it is at the center, its contribution will be 1. If it is at the faces, the contribution will be only half. And this examples, we know CgCl or CsCl, cesium chloride, cesium bromide from this body-centered cubic lattices. In BCC, atoms are located at eight corners and a single atom at the cube of the center of the cube. The coordination number in this case will be 8. What is the coordination number? The number of atoms that surround a particular atom in the crystal structure, that we call it as a unit cell. If it is a crystal is made up of atoms, if it is of ions, so there we have seen, if a particular ion is how many ions of opposite charge surround this particular ion, that is defined as, that is referred to as a coordination number of that particular ion in that ionic crystal. And this kind of crystals we you can see, like in the diamond and this CsCl, what we see is the atoms are there are 8 such atoms, means one chloride if it is here, or bromide is here, the bromides are also at the corners usually. And we see a structure of NaCl, how it looks like as well. So, and how they are arranged, so that the coordination number in this case, you can simply find the coordination number is 8. The coordination number means this you can consider all the bromide ions are at the corner and the body center, and the metal ions, if they are smaller, they'll be somewhere in the diagonal in the case of NaCl we see. So atoms touch each other along cube diagonals, that we need to understand. Along the cube diagonals means these and these atoms touch each other here, because but there are some spaces, gaps here, because atoms do not touch atoms because of the volume. This diagonal is the, if you look at, so there are one radius here means one diameter, then one radius, and this distance, if you look at, so this distance, if it is it is cube, so this distance will be divided into 4 into radius of this one cell. So that we will see how we'll find the volume and the pack. Then we see the face-centered cubic structure. Face-centered cubic structure is something that the atoms at the corners and also at the faces. So what we see, the contribution from the all 8 corners will be 1/8×8, so there will be one atom because of the corners in that particular unit cell. But we see there are 6 faces, and each face the contribution is half, so there will be 3 atoms because of the 6 faces. So total number of atoms present in one face-centered cubic unit cell is 4. 1 is because of the corners and 3 is because of the faces. In FCC, atoms located at each corner, each of the corner and the center of all the cube faces, and the examples are aluminium, copper, gold, lead, nickel, these metallic crystals. The coordination number in this case, the face centered cubic lattice, it is 12. So you should remember, if and in the BCC, what we see, the coordination number is 8. Let's see, the all the atoms touch each other along the face diagonals. The atoms will touch each other along the face diagonals. So based on this, if you know the diagonal, this thing, you know this distance diagonal as well. And diagonal or diagonal, because if it is A, this will be A√2. There, the diagonal of that cube will be A√3. That was so. Based on that, if this one distance is A, based on the radius, this 1R plus 2R plus R. So we know 2R it will be equal to A√2. So based on that, we can find out the radius of the atom as well in face-centered cubic lattice. Similarly, we can also find out the radius in the body-centered. One thing what we see is in the primitive cubic lattice, but we show only one atom was effectively in a cubic lattice, so, and in body centered, but we see there are 2 atoms, and face centered there are 4 atoms. So without doing, what I can guess that the packing will be more dense in FCC than the BCC than the primitive cubic lattices, because you see that there are how many atoms are there in that particular cubes, and how will be that packing be, we will see in details in our next class. The simple cubic structure and this packing efficiency as well, we'll see it tomorrow. The packing efficiency as well, packing efficiency, packing fraction, everything that we'll see in great details. So here you just to again see that how the FCC, BCC, particularly the cubic lattices are more important for us. The numerical problems also come on this cubic lattices. So there you should know that in FCC the atom diagonals touch here on the faces. In BCC, atom along the diagonal of this cubic cell, atoms touch each other. So based on that, if the distance or the length of one side of cube is given, based on that you can find out the radius of a particular atom. If you know the radius of that particular atom, you know you can find out the volume of the that particular atom as well. Volume is 4/3πr³, volume of a sphere. We consider these atoms as a spherical And so if you know, then again, we know how many atoms are effectively there in that particular cubic cell. So based on that, we can find out the total volume occupied by all atoms. Then again, what we know, if we know the ages, we can find out the volume of this entire cube. In the entire cube, what volume is taken by atoms? So some volume is left, that free space, that we will see what is that free space, and where whatever this volume is taken by atoms, that defines the packing, where the packing is dense, that it defines. We'll see these things in details in our next class.
Welcome to the Ramanujan app. In this video, we are going to demo JEE topics and its related resources from slides and videos. Kindly give all the necessary permission and proceed to the main screen. Let us select mathematics as our subject. This will open up the syllabus for this subject. All the syllabus data regarding the subject will be loaded at this stage. Once the process is complete, the icon will be active. Zoom a bit so that the topics are clearly visible and click on the orange highlighter button. This will open up a selection box. Adjust the box so that it covers the topic you are interested in. Once this is done, confirm your selection by clicking on the green button. This will download the slides resources for that unit. Once the download is complete, it will ask you for the permission to download the textbooks from the NCERT site. Once the download is complete, it will open up the chapter and the subchapter hierarchy for the unit. Select one of the subchapter. In this case, I am selecting the second subchapter. It will load all the resources pertaining to that topic. Let us click the second icon, that is textbook. You will be given an option if there are many resources. Now you can see, it has directly taken us to the page of the selected topic. Click on the small green button to load all the icons back. Let us click the textbook icon again and select the second option. It will open up a message box, displaying the CEngage page number for that topic. Similarly, let us select the third icon, that is slides. Let's go with the first option. It will open up the slides for the said topic. Finally, let us select the fifth icon, that is YouTube videos. This will show the videos related to the topic from IIT PAL. In this case, there are more than one video. Select any one of the links and watch the video.
Welcome to the second lecture on inverse trigonometric functions.
Similarly, let us select another topic and follow the same procedure. Remember, downloading of slides is a one-time process per unit. Slides are being downloaded here, as we have visited this unit for the first time. The next time we visit the same unit, slides will be retrieved locally. We can also select a topic from slides and get its equivalent matching resource. In this case, I am selecting the topic, straight lines, and getting its equivalent topic from the textbook, that is, straight lines, which comes under coordinate geometry. So here we have textbook resource showing straight lines. Also we have slide resource showing the slides for straight lines. When there are too many topics selected, or the topic name match is not found, the list of entire topics will be shown to the student. He can select any one topic and proceed further. Now let us see the formula sheet for maths. Formula sheet is provided to get a quick reference of all the formulas covered in the syllabus. If you want to refer to a topic from the formula sheet, simply select the topic and proceed further. We are also providing a link to the CEngage app. On clicking the CEngage icon, it will open the CEngage app. You will find all the test material inside My Bookshelf option. Finally, you can take the mock tests using the National Test Appeals app. Clicking on the icon will take you directly to the National Test Appeals app, where you can try out mock tests. Now let us try out a different subject, that is physics. Let's click on the Moodle icon, seen on the syllabus screen. This will take you to the Moodle calendar, where you will be able to view all the scheduled events. Let us click on one of the events. There is an event for physics unit 1. On clicking it, we'll give a live lecture Google Meet link in it. Clicking on the link will directly open up Google Meet app where the lecture will be taken. Let us select a topic from the physics syllabus and proceed further. Now let us click the first icon, that is GyanChat. GyanChat is a medium where the students can interact with the other students via channels. Each subject unit will be having its own dedicated channel. Students can share their doubts or thoughts via this channel. Now let us click on the fourth icon, that is Gyan Moodle. Gyan Moodle would directly take you to the course material for that particular unit. These course materials will be uploaded on Moodle by the lectures. Similarly, let us select another topic and follow the same procedure. Let us click the textbook icon and select the second option. This will open up a message box, displaying the page number of the Kindle version of HC Verma book. On clicking OK, it will open up the Kindle app with the book loaded. Once the book is loaded, click on the hamburger icon on the top and select the go to option. This opens up a dialog box asking you to enter the page number. Enter the same page number which was shown to you earlier and click OK. This will directly take you to the page related to the topic you selected. Whenever a QR code is found inside the textbook, the student can select the QR code and he will be provided with e-content material. In this particular case, we have contents related to text PDF, graphic and interactive content. In some cases, there will be video content. Let us select the text PDF content. Since this is an exemplar PDF from the NCERT site, it will ask your permission to download it from the NCERT site. Once the download is complete, it will show the exemplar. Next, let's try the graphic content. It will load the graphical resource for that topic. Finally, the interactive content. It will load the interactive content for that topic. Let us see how video content would look like from a different chapter.
Newton's first law. When you look at force, typically a force is itself defined using Newton's first law. A force is something that pushes or pulls an object and causes it to change direction, stop, change size or shape, or move faster or slower. Now, objects can be with no force. Typically, what happens is there is no alteration of either the speed at which the object is moving or the direction in which it is moving. If an object is moving, it changes direction, then too there is a force at play. Force is an external effort that happens to either a body or a system of bodies. It takes an external force to change the what is called the momentum. You already learned about vectors and scalars. Force is a vector and it has an effect on both the scalar value as well as the vector value associated with the body on which it acts. Now, there are two kinds of forces. There are forces that cause action at a distance, and then there are forces that happen because you are in touch, physical touch with the body. Now, but force in either case is external to the body that you are examining. So now let's state Newton's first law. An object remains in a state of rest or uniform velocity in a straight line unless it is acted upon by a force that causes that velocity to change. Thus, it takes a force to be applied to change either the direction, the speed, thus changing the velocity by either changing its speed or its direction. The natural tendency of a body to keep its current velocity is called inertia. When we say inertia, both the speed and the direction stay the same.
We also have live lectures by world-class and dedicated tutors.
Well, that's all for this demo. Thanks for watching.